Rugby Baptist Church family, welcome to our second scattered service, the fifth Sunday in Lent. Last week, some of us watched a video and spent some time in private prayer. Some of us had a whole mini service in their homes. Some of us called a friend and prayed with them over the phone. Some of us connected to the private Rugby Baptist Church Facebook group. It's working really well, so if you're on Facebook and you're not linked in yet, please do ask to join. Some of us use the resources on the website to have this God moment with their children. We may not be able to gather this morning as we normally do, but we are trying to offer different ways to have fellowship that will work for everyone. If you are self-isolating, we are busy setting up a scheme to help you in really practical ways. On Wednesdays, please join our prayer meeting on Zoom. We're also looking for a few more volunteers to help the pastoral care team and myself to keep in touch with everyone. And Petra is coordinating that. Do get involved. If you've got ideas, please speak up, because this is us, all of us, doing church together, being salt and light, loving one another and our neighbor as Christ loved us. It's a difficult time for many, but there is so much going on below the surface that is so good and beautiful. So think about these things. Psalm 29 says, "Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness." Amen.
Hello. The reading for today's reflection, online reflection from Rugby Baptist Church, is Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. "Rejoice in the Lord always, and I'll say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. And may God bless the reading of his word. Amen."
Hello everyone. It's really good to be with you all and sharing together in a time of prayer. I'm going to lead us in some short prayers, also leaving times of quiet for you to remember for before God the people or situations that you personally are concerned about. So let's pray. Loving Father God, thank you that you are our light and salvation and the stronghold of our lives, a very present help in times of trouble. Forgive us when we have allowed fear and anxiety to overwhelm us, and when we have forgotten that you are our sun and shield. Forgive us when we have focused our thoughts on worry and lack and despair, rather than thinking about all those things which are excellent or praiseworthy. Forgive us when we have panicked, thinking our boat would capsize and we would be overwhelmed by the storm and waves, forgetting that you were right there in the boat with us, commanding the storms around us to be still. Thank you for your promises that you were always with us, and that you will strengthen and help us, and that you will uphold us with your righteous right hand. You whisper to us, "Be still and know that I am God. Father God, we bring before you all medical staff, volunteers, scientists and researchers, and especially those from our own church fellowship who are presently working together to combat the terrible effects of the coronavirus. We pray for protection and stamina, wisdom and kindness. We pray for those nearing the end of their lives. Lord, draw near with your presence and comfort. And we also pray for the recently bereaved in their shock and grief, bewilderment and sadness. Lord, we pray for charities and businesses and for those who have suddenly lost their jobs and livelihoods. We pray for those who do not have the option of working from home. And we pray for those who are working from home and adjusting to these new circumstances. We pray for households where many people are cooped up together in cramped surroundings. We pray also for people who have no home. We pray for children and young people who can no longer enjoy friendships and the stability of school life and work. And for those experiencing the disappointments of so many cancelled events. We pray for the vulnerable and the isolated, especially those living on their own. And for those whose mental health issues mean that they are particularly struggling at this time with so much change and uncertainty. We pray for the Prime Minister and for all leaders, politicians and church ministers. Give them the strength and resources to minister effectively at this challenging time. We pray for Peter and for Emma and for their families. And we also pray for David Fleming and his family, some of whom have been affected by the virus. Lord, we remember before you now those who are especially in our hearts. Lord Jesus, thank you that you have been there in the kindness and humour, the positivity and creativity and fellowship of other people. Thank you for the skills, equipment and resourcefulness of others. Thank you for your promise that you are near and that we can rejoice in you always, bringing all our needs and prayers to you. Thank you that when we go from here, whether we are with other people or whether we are alone, your peace is with us. Yours is the peace which transcends all understanding and will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Maybe your first response to these words is, you've got easy talking there from the safety of the first century, Paul. Don't you know that for us in here, in this century, there's a global pandemic going on? Well, reality check. Paul had been shipwrecked, beaten, stoned, flogged. He wrote these words from a prison cell in Rome. Compared to a Roman prison, our self-isolation is a walk in the park. Paul had no idea whether he would be released again or maybe executed by the authorities fed up with this new fangled Christian sect. Yet from his cell, Paul reaches out to the church in Philippi, the church that he started, with the most loving, personal, and affectionate letter in the entire Bible. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. So what is the well that Paul draws on to maintain his joy in such difficult circumstances? Well, let's skim through the rest of the letter, looking for some clues. In chapter 1, verse 18, clearly his joy is in the preaching of the gospel. He says, the important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached, and because of this, I rejoice. It's in confidence in his deliverance. In chapter 1, verse 19, he says, I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help given by the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. It's in the Word of Life. In chapter 2, verse 15, he says, you Philippians, you shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the Word of Life, in order that I may boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor for nothing. But even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you. And it's in sacrifice for the gospel. In chapter 2, verse 29, he urges the Philippians to welcome Epaphroditus in the Lord with great joy and honor men like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ. So to summarize, when Paul talks about joy, he is not talking about an emotion. Joy is not happiness. Yes, of course, having joy will make you more likely to be happy, but like all emotions, happiness, it comes and goes. If tomorrow you would hear that someone you love is coming down with COVID-19, it is likely to take your happiness away from you for a while, isn't it? But it need not take your joy. Joy for Paul is a response to God's saving activity and to our own work in alignment with what God is doing in the world. It is about being in tune with the Lord in the middle of our circumstance. So, how do we get in tune? Well, let's read on. Paul says, the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything. Now, Paul, how can you say that there from your prison cell with your very life in the balance? Well, let's read on. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. How do we get in tune with the Lord? Prayer. How do we exchange our anxiety for peace? Prayer. How do we guard our hearts against bitterness and despair and depression? Prayer. Now let's be honest, prayer is not an easy fix. We are not talking about a quick 2-minute intercession here, but about deep and hard-won prayer, acknowledging who God is, recognizing in gratitude all that he has given us, repenting of our pride and our attempts to play God, and putting all of our fears and hurts before the cross and leaving them there in faith, not taking them back up again. Last week I touched on our deep-seated human need to maintain this illusion of control over our lives. And just today I read a newspaper article by a retired neurosurgeon called Henry Marsh. And this is what he writes about a panic buying. He says this, a few mornings ago I visited the local shops. Although I had enough food in the house to last me for a few days, I had to struggle to overcome an almost irrepressible urge to buy something, to buy anything, to reassert control over a frightening future. Listen, We can gain neither peace nor joy until we give up that illusion of control and say, God, you alone are in control. Not me, not the doctors, not the government. You alone are in control, and I choose to trust you with that. You alone are in control, and I choose to trust you with that. I choose to trust you with the weeks and months to come. I choose to trust you with my life. I choose to trust you with my death. I choose to trust you with my job. I choose to trust you with the people I love and with my family. I choose to trust you with my own emotions. So if your home feels to you like a prison right now, maybe do what Paul did there in his cell. Pray like you've never prayed before. The Lord is near, and I choose to turn to him in trust. No, it is not easy. But what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. And what peace we often forfeit when we don't. So if this is how we avoid our anxieties governing our thoughts, fine, but what then do we think about? Well, the final word in this passage addresses the question. It says, think about these things. Now, the advice Paul gives here, it sounds sensible, but there is more going on than meets the eye. Don't miss it. And because, as he so often does, Paul flags it up right at the start of his letter. When he says in chapter 1, verse 9, he says this, "This is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ." The key word here is discernment. Discernment rooted in knowledge of God and insight in God's ways. And that is the backdrop, I would suggest, to Paul's conclusion here in this passage that we read in Philippians 4. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Discernment. What is our standard of truth? By whose yardstick do we measure what is true, right, pure, lovely, admirable? The world does not always consider true, noble, right, pure, lovely, or admirable what God considers to be true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and admirable. There is a kingdom way of looking at the world around us that sometimes draws very different conclusions because we have this joy of seeing God at work. Pete Scazzaro tells the story of a wise man living on one of China's frontiers. One day, for no apparent reason, a young man's horse ran away and was taken by nomads across the border, and everyone tried to offer consolation for the man's bad fortune, but his father, a wise man, said, "What makes you so sure that this is not a blessing?" A month later, his horse returned, bringing with her a magnificent stallion. And this time everyone was full of congratulations for the son's good fortune, but now his father said, "What makes you so sure that this isn't a disaster?" Her household was made richer by this fine horse, and the son loved to ride it, but one day he fell from his horse and broke his hip, and once again everyone offered their consolation for bad luck. But his father said, "What makes you so sure that this is not a blessing?" And a year later, nomads invaded, and every able-bodied man was required to take up his bow and go into battle. The Chinese families living on the border lost 9 out of every 10 men who went to fight, and only because the son was crippled Did the father and son survive to take care of each other? Brothers, sisters, look around you with kingdom eyes. God can and will bring blessing out of disaster. And some of these things you can already see. Our individualistic culture is suddenly discovering that there is an us, that we all depend on each other in a profound way. Our proud elites are suddenly recognizing the humble cleaner, the warehouse operative, the shop assistant, the policeman and the nurse as the invaluable backbone of society. And suddenly the last are first. Neighbors are reaching out to each other in ways that would have been inconceivable just a few weeks ago. Our arrogant world is discovering that we are not as much in control of our destiny as we thought we were. And many will seek for the one who is in control. And they will seek and they will find him. And to our deep joy, God is inviting us to join in his work. Think about such things. Yes, our services have been cancelled. But love has not been cancelled. Prayer has not been cancelled. Conversations have not been cancelled. Reading has not been cancelled. Songs have not been cancelled. Worship as a way of life has not been cancelled. Hope has not been cancelled. The work of God has not been cancelled. Our purpose in him has not been cancelled. His goodness has not been cancelled. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice and think about such things. Amen.
You are a man. Hello everyone. No Rugby Baptist Church service is complete without notices, so here they are. Hopefully you've received this week's church newsletter by email. Please do have a read of it. If you haven't had it, and you would like to, please get in touch with me to tell me your email address. My contact details are on the church website. I'd just like to draw your attention to a couple of things in the newsletter. First, we set up a scheme to help each other with shopping, dog walking, collecting prescriptions, that sort of thing. The sort of thing you need help with if you can't go out. If you'd like to be a volunteer, please get in touch with Bridget. She's organising the scheme and she'll tell you the details about how it works. If you need help, then what you need to do is get in touch with Bridget and she will organise for somebody to come and do the things that you need help with. Second, Petra is setting up a telephone support network. So if you like chatting on the phone and would like to help with that, please get in touch with Petra. A phone call could be a real lifeline for someone at home on their own, especially if they don't have a computer and can't watch this kind of thing that we're all watching. So this would be a brilliant thing to do. I'm sure that you, like me, are missing meeting together, but we're trying out a whole new variety of ways of being church. I wonder how it's all going for you. It'd be great to get some feedback about what you think, what you're finding helpful, what you're missing, and any ideas of what we can do about it. Finally, I'm not inviting you to the Johnny's Hall today for a cup of tea and a chat, but maybe you could give someone a call later and have a chat with a friend from church and make yourself a cup of tea.
Lord Jesus, though brokenness is in us and around us, we have so many reasons to rejoice in you today. You are our perfect righteousness, our constant advocate. You are a sovereign King and loving brother. Don't let us forget. Lord, because of your nearness and kindness, we can risk being vulnerable and gentle towards others. We can risk reaching out. We don't have to be in control. We don't have to be right. We don't have to be defensive. Free us to love well in this season. Lord, you command us not to be anxious about anything. So with palms up, we give to you the people that we would love to fix, the storylines that we would love to finish, the heartaches that we would love to heal, and the circumstances that we would love to alter. And Lord, we thank you for the promise of setting your peace as a powerful guard for our hearts and minds. As long as you are with us in the storm, we can do storms. Knowing that you're with us and for us, Lord, is enough. Lord Jesus, you are the truest and noblest, most right, pure, lovely, and praiseworthy reality that we can imagine. So we set our gaze and affection on you. Take our thoughts captive to think with your mind. Focus our eyes to see what you see and appreciate all that you are doing in the world right now. And help us to do these things after you. So we pray, Lord, in your powerful name. Amen. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.